This is a computer game called Elite. This is really, well, Elite, I'll show you in a minute where we load it up, but this is, Elite was the first really proper game to use three-dimensional graphics. This current generation of gamers won't remember a time when games weren't 3D. So before that time, we had sort of games like this, which is sort of, this is the version of Pac-Man for the BBC. And this comes on tape, of course, for this computer. When a game came out which was in 3D, it just blew everybody away. I mean, the guys who wrote this are, in my view, geniuses. I mean, they wrote it, Bell and Braben. They wrote this while they were undergraduates at Cambridge. And they were probably no more than 20 years old when they wrote this. And they made this computer do something which nobody thought it could possibly do. The program that they wrote was just a work of genius, how they managed to get this phenomenal level of graphics onto this computer. So you can see this is, I will load it up shortly, but it's all wireframe, of course, not colored in, it's not shaded and lighted and lit properly, but this was revolutionary for the 1984, I think it was at the time. I really became slightly obsessed by this game, actually. And I played it and played it and played it with my mate, Pete Sidaway, who was my friend at school, and we played this thing for ages and ages and ages. It's actually one of the first, not only one of the first 3D games invented, it's one of the first open-ended games. So there's no point to the game. You can decide whether you want to, there's no levels, there's no lives involved. So computer games like this one, previously, you had three lives. If the monsters got you, you died, and you moved on to the next life. And the idea was to keep going through the levels and amassing as many points as you could. This game is completely unlike that. There's no levels. You just start off with the spaceship and you can explore the galaxy wherever you want to go. So this computer, this is it. When you bought it, didn't come with a disk drive or anything. What you did is you attached a tape recorder to it. So this is the tape for Elite. This isn't the original tape recorder we had for it. That one broke after many years of use. So this is a tape recorder we had lying around the house. So the first thing I've got to do is rewind the tape. What I'll do is I'll pull a plug out to start with so you can hear the data. Because this is the great thing about this, is you can actually hear the ones and zeros that coming out of this. This is the leader. So this is a very evocative noise from my childhood. So what you're hearing there is ones and zeros which have been recorded onto the tape. And it literally stores a one as one frequency of noise and a zero as a different frequency. And it's just oscillating between those two different noise frequencies. Right, so I'll stop that and I'll have to rewind it again now. And then we wait. Oh no, I haven't rewound it far enough. So none of this instant put a disk in a computer or boot it off a hard drive. You have to wait. You have to be patient. So now it's confused because it's loaded part of the data and I've told it to rewind. There we go. So right, it's found it now. So all these ones and zeros, all this noise is going into the computer and being translated now into data. First time I played this again, it was probably the first time in about 20 years that I played it again. And I got it down from the loft, my parents' loft, and set it all up. And I actually let my kids play it. So I've got a five-year-old daughter who really, really loved playing it. She wasn't very good at it. So now we have to wait about two or three minutes before it loads. Right, so the first thing you see, this has just blew me away the first time I saw it. I thought this is absolutely fantastic. You've got a rotating wireframe graphics spaceship on the screen. And this was just incredible. I mean, moving from Pac-Man to this was absolutely wonderful. Right, so we've got our cargo. Now we want somewhere to go. So we go to this local chart here, and we use our arrow. Let's go to reort. So center the cross on there. And we can look up data on system, so we can look up what the planet's like. I still admit to being slightly obsessed by this game. But no, the other reason is the way that they put this data into the program. So this was, you've only got 32K of data to play with. So they've created, with this 32K, you've got a whole galactic chart. So these are full, this is a galaxy of star systems. each with its own population, each with its different aliens populating the planet and different levels of technology and so on. And these eight such galaxies, there's absolutely no way you can just store all this information in 32K. This is all generated randomly. It's generated with a so-called random number generator. And that random number generator they can use to spit out whether the planet is populated by cats or by humans, or whether it's populated by whether the technology is high-tech or they're still in the Stone Age. Each one of these red buttons does something. Each one of these function keys does something. I've lost the original bar that came with the game. So I'm now going to press this button, which is going to launch us into space. So there we are. We're presented now with the planet in front of us. That's the planet Larve in front of us. So this diagram here, this tells us what's around us. So as I move through space, let's increase our speed. This is our speed gauge up down here. Rotate, so I'm pulling up the spaceship now and rotating back. There's our space station. What's that? Oh, it's a python. Right, so he's firing at us now because I've upset him by... Oh, that's wiped out the front shields. He's launched another missile. I don't think we're going to be around for very much longer. Right. So there goes our cargo spinning off into space. But after a while, I became more interested in figuring out how it worked. And I eventually became completely obsessed with figuring out how it worked. I programmed, I call it a game, but there's not much to do with it, with solid graphics. So this is wireframe graphics. But now, I should have been probably studying for my GCSEs / A levels. I was spent more time writing this than I was doing studying, which almost caused me to flunk my A levels, actually. The next generation computer had more processing power and was able to not only do wireframe graphics, but it could do graphics where you can shade in the faces as well. So I've actually ported my game to the PC. So I've taken the original code and put it on my laptop actually now. So I can show you if you want to, if you're interested in seeing this. So this is more modern, yes. So this is running about 1,000 times faster than that computer. I'm having to wait for it to boot up now. I'm having to wait, even though it's coming out from sleep, I can't just switch it on. I started programming this probably when I was just turned 17, I think it was. And I still tinker with it now. When I originally wrote this game, it was the time when if you were a guy in the bedroom with a computer, you could, like the guys who wrote Elite, you could make an awful lot of money out of one person or two people writing a computer game and selling it. So this was my dream, right? I was going to write my own computer game and sell it on. But I was a bit too late, really. By the time I sort of got anywhere with my game, it was getting into the era where teams of programmers were required to write games. Now, of course, you know, it's practically movie studios are needed to write computer games. Originally, I wrote it in Assembler, which is what Elite is written into. That's the language that the processor understands. So you write each individual instruction that goes through the processor. So they're very, very basic commands. So you can write things like add, store, subtract. That's pretty much it, actually. Shift, so you can multiply by two and things like this. So they're very, very basic commands. But once you can build up code, so you have to write an awful lot of it, but you can write routines and things which will create these fantastic graphics. So originally I wrote in Assembler, which was actually for the Acorn Archimedes at the time. I wasn't writing for the BBC. I was writing in ARM Assembler, which is now the processors you find in a great majority of mobile phones around the world. So Acorn, the original company that made the BBC Micro and the Archimedes, eventually went bust, but not before it had spun off this other company called ARM, which was the company that made the chip, the processor for the Acorn Archimedes. And that chip is now used in a tremendous number of mobile phones and mobile applications all around the world. So I wrote in ARM Assembler, but rapidly it became obvious that to get anywhere with it, it was just too hard to write in ARM Assembler. You can't, to make progress faster, I had to write in a higher level language. So eventually I wrote it in C. And C has the advantage that you can port it, so it means you can take the code you've written on one machine, and with only a little bit of tweaking, if you've written it just right, you can take that code and you can put it on another computer and you can compile it for a different computer. So in fact, I took the code that I wrote for the Archimedes, and originally I ported it over to the Mac. And it worked just as happily on the Mac with a bit of tweaking. And then when I got rid of my Mac, I bought and got a PC. I ported it over to the PC, and I've carried on just fiddling with it, really. So I call this Arena. It's a sort of, it sounds a bit like something that, nowadays it sounds a bit like something that would be on a Gerry Anderson film. But sort of a combination of the word aura and arena. So like arena is in battle, and aura is in something sort of slightly mystical or something like, you know. With hindsight, it's a slightly embarrassing name, but I can't change it now. It's the same. I have to stick with that name. This is your spaceship. So unlike Elite, I've put an avatar spaceship in. So there's the spaceship. So this is essentially what I had on the Acorn Archimedes. I've put in more graphics over time as the processor, the computers have got more modern and are able to handle it. So the planet now has got actually, you know, these are the real continents on the planet. That's Africa there. Admittedly, they're a bit blocky. So we've got Africa coming up. That's South America, look there. And there's North America. And there's Europe up there. So I've, you know, mucked around with it. And I've also given Earth some rings, which it doesn't have. So this is something that Elite couldn't do, is that I can fly backwards in this. So it's obeying Newtonian mechanics, this means. It's nothing to look at compared with modern computer games. Because yeah, I've written... Modern computer games are written with a graphics engine in mind. They're either OpenGL or something like this, or DirectX or something like that. Whereas this one, I've written the graphics engine from scratch. This is my own graphics engine. In fact, it's not making use of any hardware acceleration at all. It's just running on the processor. I'm quite proud of I've written my own graphics engine. So I'm a physicist now. I'm employed by the university as a physicist. I think basically the writing this game, it's not a game, but writing this bit of graphics here is probably one of the biggest reasons why I'm doing what I'm doing now. And I wasn't interested actually in going into the computer games industry eventually. I decided that I was more interested in writing the thing than playing it. And if you're going into the computer games industry, you've got to be really enthusiastic about computer games. And I just, after Elite, I couldn't care less, really. But what it did do was it taught me a certain way of thinking, I think a certain logical way of thinking, a certain structured way of thinking, especially the debugging, the so-called debugging of the programs is probably, teaches you a lot about logic and finding your own answers to problems. If you've got a program like this and it doesn't work, you've got to go through the program and find out which bit of the program doesn't work, where have you made a mistake somewhere. So you've got to very logically go through step by step and find out whereabouts in the program that the program is not working or not working in quite the way you want. And sometimes all you get when you run a program like this after you've made a change is it just spits out nothing. It just says segmentation fault or worse, it just crashes the machine entirely. And from that point, you've got to work out what the problem is with the program. And it teaches you a very logical, structured way of thinking. And of course, physics is also you have to think in a very logical way in terms of coming about an experiment in physics to try and work out what it is working with the experiment or where the errors are with the experiment, this kind of thing. So this probably goes a long way to explaining where I am now. I have to admit, it's slightly addictive doing this. But it is very difficult, I think, nowadays. I mean, if you pick up a machine like this is a complicated piece of equipment, this PC. And to pick it up as a child now and start to do a computer program is very, very difficult. I mean, you're not presented with a cursor, like as in the BBC Micro, when you can just start typing. You're presented with this, you know, mouse and graphics and all these windows and things. And there's a lot of distractions there. You can't just immediately start typing at your first computer program and so on. You're distracted by the internet and all this other stuff. So you've really got to, if you want to start learning to program one of these things, you've really got to try. You've really got to know, you've got to download a program, like a basic program or C or some compiler like this. And then really make an effort to try and start learning programming. Whereas when you switch on one of these BBC Micros, it's practically natural. I mean, first thing you've got to do is start typing commands into it. No, I'm not a gamer at all, actually. I'm not, I don't play computer games at all. The only computer game I'll admit to playing is SimCity, and I only play that occasionally. But I'm really not interested in playing computer games. I know a lot of people are, but after Elite, I became more interested in actually writing the thing rather than and how it worked, which is part of the reason why I never made anything of this. I never actually could be bothered to turn it into anything more that you could play and shoot things and go and do all the wonderful things that you can do in Elite with.
What's the future for Arena?
This is probably it. I find less and less time to do anything with it these days. There's a sort of, probably in the last week, I've done more on it than I've done in the past 10 years. Oh. That's not supposed to happen.
So if you've been doing some programming or coding of your own, whether it was 20 years ago or 20 minutes ago, we'd love to see it. Send an email to myself or Sean. We'll have the email address on the screen and we'll have a look. We love that kind of stuff. And who knows, maybe we'll put something here on Computerphile. By the way, I'm in Sean's office. There's no way I'd have this PC rubbish. Leave comments underneath.